Welcome to this week's episode of Drawing on Experience by Noname, Porter-McShirley, produced by Riffle Publishing Incorporated. This is a little story about some kids, a turtle, the times that time slows down, painfully slow, and how you can stay out of trouble. Back when I was a small kid, my siblings and I had almost nothing. No TV, no school to go to, no library, no friends. The internet didn't exist. Cell phones didn't exist. We did not have bicycles or skateboards. We did have one set of encyclopedias, five or six other books, Bibles, a small set of Lincoln Logs, some plastic farm animals, four or five toy vehicles, some dolls and dishes, a few comic pages from newspapers, and whatever we could make with our imaginations, a little bit of paper, and broken crayons. Sometimes we could listen to Old West drama shows on the radio, like The Lone Ranger and Tonto, or Gunsmoke, but I was too young to understand anything when my dad had the radio tuned to the news. Even what I gleaned from the dramas was mostly handed down to me through my older brother, as he would take the lead in a lot of our playtime. So, one day, when a box turtle happened to come walking through our grass, us kids might have asked our parents if we could keep it. Or maybe our dad might have thought it would be a good thing to make us learn responsibility. I don't remember that part. I do remember that for some time, the turtle lived in a plastic tub of dirt underneath our broken-down vehicle. There were holes in the bottom of the tub that bugs entered, which I guess is mostly what the turtle ate, along with plants that grew up and hung over the sides of the tub. A few times per week, as I recall, the three of us children were supposed to take the turtle out of the tub and let it walk for exercise. Turtles have some strong sense of direction and purpose in their walking. They try repeatedly to go a certain direction, even if you turn them around. So, we were supposed to keep track of the turtle until it reached the edge of our yard, then pick it up and carry it back to the first side of the yard, and repeat a few times. The problem was, true to their name, Box Turtle, whenever disturbed, these kinds of critters pull all their legs, tail, and head inside their shell and pull it closed. And they sit like a little box, motionless, protected like nature's little armored trucks. And they wait. And wait. And wait. Until by sound or vibration, they think nothing is around and it's safe to open up. But a 4 or 5-year-old girl and her siblings can't hold still that long, just waiting for the turtle to open up and start walking. We would busy ourselves with imaginatory games that involved running around the yard and talking to each other, like pretending we were the Lone Ranger and Tonto scouting out some area, or pretending to shoot imaginary rabbits with a piece of wood that served as a toy gun, and roasting them over imaginary campfires, and pretending to make coffee with seeds of weeds we gathered at the edge of the yard. We got so wrapped up in our activities that we would forget all about the turtle for, I'm guessing, at least 30 minutes, or until our dad would yell out the window asking if we were watching it. So then we would frantically search the grass, sometimes needing our dad to help find the little creature which had scampered away while we weren't looking. Looking back on this, I believe we were right to use our imaginations to occupy ourselves. But our mistake was to not center our imaginations around the turtle we were charged with observing. We could have pretended the turtle was a money transport wagon traveling across the prairie lands when it broke an axle and couldn't move until one of the drivers rode one of its horses to some town and came back with a new axle. And so we were the guards, positioned strategically to the sides, hiding up on the hillside or behind the lonely bush, ready to defend the wagon against thieves. We could have decided the ants roaming the ground were cattle foraging. The bumblebee was a wandering bear, and a little spider in the grass was a coyote waiting for a rabbit to venture near him. When a bird flew over our heads, making a passing shadow, we could have said the vultures were circling because the horse poop stank like death in the hot sun. The grasshopper could have been a deer bounding across the open prairie just for the fun of running. We could have talked about what the money wagon's guards would be doing to stay awake, like telling each other stories or singing songs. None of this would have been beyond our little minds at the time, but we just lacked someone to suggestively point us in the right direction, instead of yelling at us for losing the turtle. So I'm passing on this retrospective story and the following ideas, in the hopes that it will help jumpstart your thinking when you are bored, or that you will share this with someone who needs to hear it. There's no need to get in trouble for watching stupid human videos or popping virtual balloons when you're supposed to be listening to the boring teacher, or minding the repetitive machine at your factory job, or waiting the interminable 8 long minutes for a tray of cookies to bake, or you're a security guard who hasn't seen anything but starlings on the camera system for 6 long hours. You can find a way to make life interesting without losing sight of your responsibilities. And if you don't think you have a creative imagination, here are 2 exercises to help you see that you can do it. Number 1. Think of the most goofy, creative, imaginative, humorous person or people whom you have either known or watched in video, and ask yourself, what would they have to say about what you are faced with? What jokes would they make? How would they turn things upside down? Once you've done that, you've just created something funny, the way you've seen it done. Number 2. Recall some crazy dreams you've had along the way, and notice how your mind took bits of reality to mix, twist, exaggerate, and remake into those wild dreams. That's you being imaginative in your unconscious, and so you can follow the example consciously to entertain yourself in connection to your current reality. More ideas to help you enliven what you always thought was boring. Find both serious and goofy answers to each of these questions. What are some connections between what I'm tending and other parts of my life? How does this job site look to my boss or my boss's boss? Why did the engineer design things this way? What is it like for the mechanic to have to work on this equipment the way it's designed or installed? What if a comedian had to do stand-up based on this one room and what's happening here? How could I explain the what's and why's of everything around me to some visiting kids full of curiosity? And once you have a few interesting or funny thoughts, consider sharing them with a coworker, because if you can laugh together, you will have brightened their day and you will both feel a little lighter. So this brings us to the end of this week's drawing. I hope you'll join me next week for another drawing in a completely different story. Until then, check out my daily doodles that are only a minute long, right here on the same channel. Thank you for watching, and I'd be honored if you chose to recommend this channel to your friends. Have a wonderful day, and I'll see you again soon.